You are watching Bones and Stones. I am watching a stag beetle. This is a rehydrated dried specimen of the species Cyclommatus metallifer, which is native to Indonesia. Seven subspecies are known, and this one is called finae, its key identifying feature in males being the absence of a yellow spot on the back of the femur. Here's a photo showing all of the subspecies so you can see what I mean. And here is the distribution map so you can see where this subspecies comes from. Right, preamble over, let's get started. Before we reach for our instruments, we must of course inspect the surface anatomy. Yes, this is the head, and the most important part of any head are the eyes. If I zoom in further, you can see that, like all insects, this beetle has compound eyes. Look closely, appreciate the tiny components we call ommatidia. You are looking directly at their corneas, which refract light into the photoreceptors. Unlike human eyes, ommatidia tend not to have separate lenses. Let's zoom out now. The segment below the head is the thorax. For any insect thorax, the dorsal plates, or the roof if you like, can be divided into three parts, the pronotum, the mesonotum, and metanotum. In beetles, the pronotum is hypertrophied, that is to say, it's gotten very big, so that's all you can see here. Now let's move up to the most striking feature of any stag beetle, the antlers, which are present only in the males. These antlers are just modified mandibles, mainly used for wrestling other males. The other mouth parts are here, we'll see those later. And moving back down, we have the head again, the pronotum of the thorax, and then we have the abdomen, which is a beautiful metallic bronze, hence the name of the species, metallifer, which is Latin for abounding in metal. If I zoom in, we can see that it's covered in tiny holes, which are called spiracles. I'll hopefully explain what they're for later. This triangle bit here is called the scutellum, and it's a vestigial structure, what remains of the mesonotum and metanotum I told you about earlier. Then, running down the middle, we have the suture line, which divides the two wing cases. These wing cases are called the elytra. Embryologically speaking, an elytron is just a hardened forewing, which now protects the hindwing folded beneath it. Only beetles have elytra. In fact, it's one of the main gimmicks. I'll try to open them now to show you the wings. Well, it's proving a bit fiddly at the moment. Right, I'll have to do it properly later. I'm going to flip the beetle over now so you can see its underside, the ventral aspect. First, looking closer at the mouth, you can see the longer maxillary palps and the shorter labial palps, which are organs of touch and taste, and then the maxillae in between. Then you can see the antennae. If we zoom in, you can see that they are what we call lamellate antennae. They look like a stack of dinner plates. There's a multitude of different antennae shapes among the insecta, all with different advantages, but generally speaking, the larger and more bristly the antennae, the larger the surface area, and so the more sensory hairs you can fit on them. There is evidence that smaller antennae like this indicate a narrower range of odorants needing to be detected, which you might expect if the insect has a limited diet. This stag beetle likes to drink tree sap and fruit juice in particular, so there you go. Anyway, moving down, we have the sternum of the thorax, which has the first set of limbs. Then we have the sternum segments of the abdomen, where you can see the articulations of the other two sets of limbs. Here you can see the end piece of a limb called a tarsus. The other two segments of an insect's limb are of course the femur and tibia. Yes, the anatomist basically just copied all of the terms from human anatomy. If we zoom in on the tarsus, the insect equivalent of the ankle, we can see the sensory hairs, and then at the end, the claw. When you meet the beetle man, you must shake him by the hand. Now we have adequately said hello, we can begin the dissection. First, I glued it onto some cardboard. It's not some special cyanoacrylate, it's just bog-standard Gorilla Glue. Now we take some vanners, which are those same microsurgical scissors beloved by ophthalmologists, and we snip off all the legs. The legs are not interesting to dissect, and they'll just get in the way otherwise, so they have to go. Next, we snip down the midline of the ventral abdomen, and then create some flaps. This allows us to open the abdomen like a wardrobe. The first thing we can see is a yellow mass. This is the fat body, which is a mass of adipocytes that serves as the main energy storage, as well as a regulator of hormones. Remember that this is a dried specimen, so the quality of the organs isn't what it used to be. This dried fat actually looks remarkably like the subcutaneous fat in a preserved human cadaver. Anyway, I'll pick away at this fat now and see what we can find. Buried in the middle of the fat body, we can see the guts. You can see the thinner midguts at the top there, which becomes more bulbous as it turns into the hindgut down here. This hindgut, known as the colon, is extra large in this species because it has to absorb all of that water from the tree sap that these stag beetles feed on. You may now notice lots of white tendrils covering everything. If I zoom in, you can get a better look. They seem to be originating from the body wall, and that is because they come from those spiracles I showed you earlier. These white tendrils are called tracheoles, and they take air from the spiracles directly to the internal organs. Yes, it's the beetle's respiratory system. Insects don't have lungs, they don't need them. Insects are simply small enough that oxygen can diffuse directly from the atmosphere through these tracheoles and directly into insect cells. Next, I'll open up more of the abdomen. You can instantly see thick muscle attached to the wall. These muscles move the legs and wings. You can also see I've just pulled out a dark brown branching structure. This is the dorsal blood vessel. Insects have an open circulatory system, so there's no true heart. Their body fluid, which we call hemolymph, just floats about in the body cavity and gets pumped around as the muscles contract. However, insects do then need this dorsal blood vessel to pump the hemolymph in the opposite direction, so as to maintain some sort of unidirectional flow. Some segments of this dorsal blood vessel contract rhythmically, like a heart, so some people call them hearts, but don't be fooled, they are not true hearts. Now, if I dissect more, you can see more of the muscle. That is a lot of muscle. It seems stag beetles are full of it. If we zoom in, we can see the individual muscle fibres. It looks suspiciously like beef jerky, and that's because beef jerky is also dried muscle. Hey, I've just noticed that all of my rough pushing and prodding of the abdomen has opened up the elytra. So let's take a look at those lovely wings. Look how they fold neatly in half. Here are the veins in the wing, which are just tubes of hemolymph that contain tracheoles and a nerve. In this dried specimen, the hemolymph seems to have given these veins the same colour as that dorsal blood vessel I showed you. Makes sense. As for the wing itself, it's just cuticle folded around these veins. Let's move up now and snip open the thorax. It's just full of muscle. Not very interesting to look at. It'll mainly be the flight muscles, which is why there's so much. Let's go to the head. I bet it's going to be very difficult to find anything in the head, as insect heads are normally so packed, and this specimen isn't greatly preserved. First, can you see that white cord sticking out at the bottom? This is actually the ventral nerve cord, and will lead to the brain. You can even see smaller nerves sticking out of the nerve cord, and penetrating the muscle fibres that got pulled out of the thorax with it. This ventral nerve cord is the insect equivalent of the human spinal cord. Yes, we vertebrates have dorsal nerve cords as compared to the ventral nerve cords of arthropods. This one here will definitely run along the underside of the thorax and abdomen, but we just won't have seen it because of our ventral surgical approach. Let's open up the head then. Here's the main attraction, the muscle that serves the mandible, and this is easy for me to prove. Watch this. Yes, these mandibular muscles are huge and take up most of the head, which is what we expect. Wrestling requires a lot of strength. Let's focus on the other mouth parts now. These two feathery yellow bits are called galea, which is Latin for helmet, and they are just protuberances of the maxillae. Instead of looking like helmets though, in this species they are large and feathery because they're adapted to soaking up all of that liquid tree sap the beetle feeds on. The tube in the middle of the galea is the labium, or lips, which are also bristly to lick up the sap. And so the beetle uses the galea to soak up the sap, then moves them in and out of its mouth to feed, as though licking a lollipop. Right, I think that just about wraps it up then. We've seen all of the major organs, and explored how they adapted in this particular species for its particular lifestyle. So if you enjoyed any of it, please like and subscribe, because I do intend to make more of these videos in the near future. Thank you for watching, and have a good rest of your day.